Welcome to the Allen Public Library, where we have an outstanding program where Lee Reed is going to portray William Cathy, the only known documented female Buffalo soldier.
I was born to Martha. My name is Cathy. We belong to William Johnson. I was amongst many slaves that he owned. At the ripe old age of 4 years old, I began doing chores. I learned to learn cooking, sewing, some nursing, and mostly I took care of the master's baby. One day a rider came and said, "The Yankees are coming, the Yankees are coming, the Yankees are coming." What is a Yankee and why is he afraid of him? Grown people are whispering. I'm trying to hear, trying to figure out what they're saying. All I know is the mistress is very nervous because her husband had died and it was just her and her son running the plantation. Soon, a band of Union soldiers, the infantry, 8 infantry from Illinois, they came, and the colonel's name was Colonel Benton. He burned down the plantation I was on and all the plantation around us, and he took us as contraband. And I'm confused, what is contraband and why is he taking me from my home? So we leave there and we go down to Little Rock, Arkansas. At Little Rock, Arkansas, we get on this big boat. I ain't never seen so much water. It's the Mississippi River, it's wide, and his boat goes like this. And all this water and steam is coming out, and it makes all this noise. As we're going down the Mississippi, we run into a rebel boat. It was trying to sneak cotton down to New Orleans. We blew it up. Pow, pow, smoke and all this. And I'm like, oh, all those people on that boat, are they hurt or what? And we keep going down the Mississippi. Finally, we get to New Orleans. We disembark at New Orleans, and this is the little short man running around barking orders, and everybody's afraid of him. Colonel Benton, everybody's afraid of him. And I'm like, why are they afraid of him? It was Phil Sheridan. So all the guys that I grew up with, they immediately joined the Army. They became part of the U.S. Colored Troops. They were volunteers. So all us girls that were big enough, they brought us all out, and they took this thing, metal thing, out of this wagon. And the man put it together, he took it apart, and he told each of the girls to put it together. So I watched, they couldn't do it. So I put it together, and I put it together correctly. So that's how I became Phil Sheridan, top cook in lunches. You know what that thing was? It was a stove. I ain't never seen a stove. We cooked in fire pits. I ain't never seen a stove. It was the best thing I ever seen. So as the war progressed, we get orders to go east toward Atlanta. And we burning everything 50 miles wide. And war lingers on. As time progressed, I grow my dress. They gave me these wonderful breeches. Man, this is the first time I feel free because wearing a dress is awful. I'm a laundress, so I have to wash clothes in a big wooden barrel over fire. A lot of the girls' dresses caught fire and they got terrible burns on their legs. So now I feel real free. I'm never gonna wear a dress again. As the war progresses, we go to Pea Ridge. At the Battle of Pea Ridge, I'm shooting. The guys teach me how to shoot because the people over there, they don't like us. This war is about me and my family and all people who look like me. So definitely they're taking pot shots at me. So they learn me to defend myself. I'm shooting pow, 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 pow. Oh man, this is exciting. I don't know if I hit anybody. I'm just shooting. So we lay there and we keep marching. We have a couple other scrimmages, but the baddest one was the Shenandoah Valley. We get to Shenandoah Valley, it lasts for days. And part of my duty is after the battle is over, I have to go out and pick up the wounded. So as I went out to pick up the wounded, some of the guys that I grew up with, they died. This is the first time I seen anybody dead. And my heart was broken because I knew these guys. Now, the war really sinks in at first it was all exciting. I was doing something I had never done before, and I'm learning how to shoot a gun. I was so excited, but now I understand when I shoot that, what that goes, that could kill somebody. Now my heart is disheartened. I'm sad. I'm sad the rest of the war. It goes on and on. We besieged Atlanta. We strangled Atlanta. No food going in and out. Man, there's people in there. It's color folks in there. They're starving. This is not fair, is what I'm thinking. Finally, we finally capture Atlanta, and then Phil Sheridan get orders. We're gonna go back to D.C. As we're going back to D.C., we get word that Lee surrenders Grant. Everybody's happy, the war's over, the war's over. Now, what are they going to do with 180,000 black men that were soldiers? So they gave this decree that all the slaves that was captured, they sent them back to where they was captured from. As I'm in the station waiting to board the train with a couple of me and the other girls, they still wear a dress, and I'm the one. So this nice general, he came by and gave me a pretty dress. And I said, thank you, sir, so much. I really appreciate it. When he walked off, I threw it away before I got on the train, because I'm never, ever going to wear a dress. When we get back to Missouri, my cousins, they were still in the military. They had to muster out of U.S. colored troops and muster in. They had to wait till the government passed this act. July 28, 1866, Congress passed the Reorganization Act. That act was passed on the 39th Congress through a light session of the 39th Congress. It was passed to let black men join the military, because before then, we're volunteers. American Revolution, the volunteers, you fight for us, you're free, but they send them back to slaves. War 1812, you fight for us, we'll get your freedom. Some of them went back as slaves. But Lincoln freed the slaves during the Civil War. So now Congress passed this act. And this act that we celebrate July 28th is National Buffalo Soldier Day. So now a recruiting station went out in Jefferson, Missouri, and New Orleans. My cousins and friends, they were over there in the barracks. So for days and days, I sit outside the recruiting station. Before I do this, I need to know what's going on. So they have this bugle. They blow this bugle. They tell them when to get up, when to go eat lunch, when to stop working, when to eat, when to go to bed. So I snuck into the barracks. And I said, cuz, I want to join the Army. He said, I want to join the Army. He said no, so we had a fight. So you know us ladies, whatever we want, we're going to get it. So I convinced him and other guys, about 10 of them to be exact, because it's not enough for me to just put on clothes, men's clothes. I have to have protection to carry out my secret. So the next morning, I went down to the recruiting station. I sit out there and waited till like 10 minutes to 11. Because I know they're going to blow that horn at 11 o'clock for him to go to lunch. So I waited 10 minutes to 11. I saw that, and I ran in the recruiting office. And I walked over there, sir. And I said, sir, I would like to join the Army. He said, what's your name? I said, William Cathy, sir. How old are you? 24. He said to me, ah, damn, I'm in the Army now. Okay, I fooled that recruiter. Look at this nice uniform they gave me. But I'm not in the Army yet. I have to take a physical, and then I have to get sworn in by an officer. So the next morning, I wait. I didn't get the front of the line. I didn't get the back of the line. I got in the middle. So when I get there, he says, raise your hands. Let me see your hands. Your feet. He took his hand, and he ran up my spine. He said, you in. Hot damn, another step. Oh, wow, I'm in the Army. Oh, now, tomorrow, I have to go and swear the oath of office, and I have to look this man in the eye. So all night long, I'm praying, because the more you can tell that I'm a girl if you look me in the face. This is after the Civil War. Black men did not look white men eye to eye. They walked around and talked to them like this, never looked them eye to eye. So all night long I prayed. God, please help me. So they called us all out there and made us stand at attention for about an hour. Captain Merriman came out on the step, said, raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear, defend the Constitution and the Union? You say, yes, yes. Ha! Damn, I'm in the Army now. Oh, wow. See these gold eagles on my chest? I get to make $13 a month, and I get to go west. So now, every day, we're in training. We have to learn how to march. I already knew how to march 12 miles a day. I could do that. With a pack, I could do that. Be marching, and we're in shooting. And I'm showing out. Pow, 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 pow. See, God punishes you when you're bragging. So I wake up in the hospital. I've had an accident. I don't know why I'm there. So all day long, I lay in the covers like this, play possum. So finally, Orly comes, and he say, wake up. Put this on you. I caught smallpox. 35% of the military got smallpox or cholera, but I got smallpox. So I got all these spots on my face and my arms, so I hurried to put all this salve on my face and arm because I don't want them to discover my secret. So while I'm in the hospital, they have cotton. This is what I need to help carry on my ruse, to keep my cover. So I hurry up and heal, and me and about 12 other soldiers, we heal, and they send us to catch up with our unit. We get to the Mississippi on the east side, and we go across again on a big boat. We get across, then we go to Fort Wallace, Kansas, to catch up with the rest of our people. So when I get to Fort Wallace, Kansas, we're bivouac on the outside. The commander of the post wouldn't let us in because he didn't want all those black men in with those women because all his troops were pulled out to go to Fort Robinson, Nebraska, because Chief Romanos of the Northern Cheyenne had attacked. So he sent them to help them. But that was a ruse to get them out because Chief Romanos had in mind to kill Libby Custer. Because Custer killed Black Kettle, which was his cousin. He wanted revenge. But can you imagine how they felt when they attacked the fort and all these black men in these blue coats were shooting at them? They were startled. I know this because Libby Custer writes in her diary, the brave men of the 38th Infantry Company A defended this fort gallantly against Chief Romanos. Four natives were killed, no damage to the fort. No damage to the soldiers. So she was in at least one battle. So we left Fort Wallace, Kansas. We proceed on. We take the southern Santa Fe Trail to go to Fort Cummins. We have to cross the Red River. That's between Texas and Oklahoma. Then in the Panhandle, we have to cross the Canadian River. That's up above Amarillo, between Amarillo and Dumas. You have to cover to that. Then we proceed west to Santa Fe. We have to cross the Rio Grande. Now I have crossed the Rio Grande. We have crossed the Rio Grande River, the Canadian River, and Red River. All in the dead of winter. I didn't have one pair of shoes and two pair of socks. And as we was marching, because we're in Corner Parker's territory, we didn't have no fire. We had eat cold food all the way. So we marched down from Santa Fe all the way down to El Paso. We get to El Paso, Fort Bliss, we rest. Then we have to cross the Rio Grande again to get to Fort Cummins. Fort Cummins is 150 miles west of Fort Bliss on the Southern Butterfield Trail to California. Fort Cummins was open, just like Fort Bliss, was to protect our southern borders from Mexico and raiders. So now I'm in the post. I have to report for duty on time. I can't be a hero, I can't be a coward. I just be a regular soldier, and I was a good soldier. I didn't gamble, I didn't smoke, and I didn't drink, and I didn't mess with the laundress and the saloon girls. So as time goes on, because I'm in the barracks with 85 men, more and more other men find out I'm a girl. This is a hard secret to keep. And it poses a security risk for the men that's protecting me. And then there are men that's married. They kept going to my cousins and everybody telling me to get out. So, you know, I'm stubborn. No, I'm going to stay in because I want this land grant. I want to be in for 3 years, get my land grant. So we find out that Captain Clark is about to retire. He's going to retire in November. So now I'm desperate because the new man coming in might not be as nice as Captain Clark. The new man coming in ain't going to have as much to do. So in the end of July, I report for sick duty, just like I have done the whole time. Every 28 days, I report for sick duty. I report for sick duty, playing the pains in my side. 15 days, 20 days. What am I going to do to make him check me? 30 days, 40 days, 50 days. 55 days. When you pray, God will give you answer. The white guy, the hospital is divided, blacks and white. The white side, they have a white orderly take care of him, and they have black orderly take care of me. The white guy has a heart attack. Ha-ha, this is what I'm going to do. Day 60, I couldn't wait for the orderly to get there. I'm counting his steps. I know when he step on that step to be in there. Oh, God, help me. Oh, my heart is, I can't breathe. Oh, help me. So he runs and get the doctor. Now the doctor have to check me. He don't have to check me for pains in my side. But if I'm having a heart attack, he have to do something. They didn't have stethoscopes in the old days. They had this wooden tube. He had to put to his ear, but he had to put to my chest. Now take all of this off. When I take all this off, the doctor run, Captain Clark. You know, Private Cat is a woman. What? Private Cat is, no, that's my back soldier. I don't care. Private Cat is a woman. Captain Clark come and see. And he look. He don't say nothing. He's so mad, he don't say nothing. He leaves, and then I'm scared. Now, what are they going to do? Because he knows. Now, for me to be here this long, he knows. And he noticed that whenever he put me on patrol that I wasn't with these certain guys. So he know these guys know. He know they for certain they do, but all the men in the barracks. So he comes back. He says, I'm going to give you this paper. You go to Fort Baynard. You kept this secret here. You better keep this secret. When I get out, I'll send back orders for them to give you honorable discharge. Because if you don't, I'm going to hang all those men in your barracks because they knew. And I said, yes, sir. So I went to Fort Baynard. I kept my secret over there. And he kept his word. He sent back, and he gave me an honorable discharge with 50% disability. Now, the Army think that they're done with me, but I don't know. In 1892, I present myself in Trinidad at the Office of Pensions, and I want to apply for my disability. I hired some lawyers in Washington, D.C., two white guys, William and Charles King. Now, I told them that on my papers, it says William Cathay. They write Cathay Williams, Cathaywillims. This is where this controversy about my name. So when they sent it to the adjutant general, he says, I didn't have a soldier named Cathay Williams, but I did have one named William Cathay, so he allowed for them to give me a checkup. So I go to take the checkup. The doctor examines me, and at this time, I lost all the toes on both of my feet. I can't walk, and I can hardly hear. Now, I applied for disability because I said I had frostbite, and I lost all my toes from crossing all those rivers because I couldn't let the doctors check my feet because my feet don't look like men's feet. So, and I couldn't hear a neuralgia. So the doctor that checked me, he said, well, since I could answer most of his questions and all that, he wrote that I should get a 40% disability because I had lost all my toes from frostbite. That's what he wrote. But the Adjutant General rejected me because when I signed up in the military, I said that I was 24 years old. My name was William Cathy. So he rejected me on that basis because on my enlistment papers and on my discharge papers says nothing about frostbite. It says that I was always in the hospital for side pains and stuff. So that's why he denied me. So I never got my pension. And that is the story of William Cathy, the only documented female Buffalo soldier. This is my enlistment papers. It says William Cathy, a cook, 24 years old, 5'9". I swore the oath of office. This is the most important document. This document makes me be the only documented female Buffalo soldier. I am not the first, I'm not the only. They're in Texas. From 1866 to 1869, there were over 400 women that they discovered that was women as soldiers. Most of them was in the cavalry and few of them was in infantry. But when they got out, they didn't try to get their disability because who was going to marry them? I didn't care. I kept this. And I tried to get my pension. This document says, when I applied for my pension, it says, age at enlistment 16, and I served for 22 months. Now, all the Cathy's documents is 27 to be exact. All the time she went to the hospital as she was going, but the most important one was her discharge papers, because without that paper and her trying to get a disability, I wouldn't be able to tell you this story. And she is the only documented female Buffalo soldier. She is not the first and not the only. There were other brave women who decided to pick up a gun and put on clothes to be in the military. Not until President Truman, June the 12th, 1948, he signed a decree, another act, to let women join the military. The first was the Waves. Just like the women, women in World War I and World War II, they volunteered, they were nurses, and they worked in the mail corps. But June 12, 1948, President Truman signed a law to let women join the military. And that's why Cathy, before that time, that's why Cathy and all the other thousands of women that snuck in the Army, white and black, snuck in the Army is for that reason. And some of them went to follow their husbands, some went to find husbands, and some went, like Cathy, to be independent and make own money. So even if they didn't get a land grant, they still kept all the money. She kept all the money. When she got out, she had $246. Well, that was a lot of money in 1868. So she got her little piece of land in Trinidad. I don't know exactly where Cathy's buried, somewhere in Trinidad, Colorado, because when she applied for a disability, she was working for a colonel there. I won't say his name because his family is still alive, and I don't want people going over there bothering their graves, because I know you do know that they buried her on their land. Cathy was born September 43 to William Johnson on the plantation. It was in Jefferson City. When slaves were born and they were listed by who owned them, they didn't have a last name. Most slaves took their name from the person that owned them. Cathy decided to take her last name from William Johnson. His name was William Johnson. So she took the name William, and her mother took the name William. So Martha became Martha Williams, and Cathy became Cathy Williams. Now Cathay Williams, William Cathy. So when she enlisted, she put her name, Williams Cathy. And I found most of the information about Cathy from the slave narratives, mostly from her documents. and an interview that she did to a St. Louis reporter. So the stuff in the middle about her going to the hospital and all that, and got it from her, because she told him this is how she got out of duty. It was very hard for people in the 1800s. And Cathy did not want to be a burden. That's why she decided to go and join the military, because she'd get $13 a month, 150 acres of land after she stayed there for 3.5 years. And as we were going, we marching, it was long march, and it's in the dead of winter. It's cold. My feet are cold. I'm suffering. We crossed the Rio Grande River, all those rivers. So finally, when we get to Fort, I get the rest. So I immediately go to the hospital. And while they're not looking, I tend as best I can to my feet. And then I gather all the cotton I need. It's a hard secret to keep, because I can't be a hero because I don't want to bring attention. I can't say that I can read or write because they would have made me in charge. And I knew that them men weren't going to let me be in charge of them. I'm 5'9". I'm taller than most of the men, almost all of the men, because the average man was my height, 5'5". As we were marching, just like always, 40 miles a day on beans and hay. We had salt bacon and beans that we cooked over fire, a low little fire that wouldn't make no smoke. We warmed them up, and we ate the beans out the can. And we had some peaches. We had some other things. This was the most exciting thing that I ever did, was being in the military. Even though I had some confrontations with some of the men who resented me being there, but they didn't go tell on me. All the black men that was in my unit, they knew that I was a woman, but they didn't tell on me. So that's how. And they were pretty decent men. And even their wives, some of their wives was nice to me and some of them wasn't, because they resented what I was doing. But some of the wives was nice to me. All in all, Cathy had a pretty good life. You know, some might say it was sad how she ended up, but to her, it afforded her independence. Imagine, she made her way at 16 years old and joined the Army, and marched and fought and did everything that she was supposed to do, just like any soldier serving today. She served her time well, just like all the other women. As an example, at Fort Elliott in the Panhandle where I'm from, Henry O. Flimford, 10th Cavalry, had a battle with Quan Parker. And when they dressed, 15 soldiers got killed. When they dressed them out, they find 5 of them were women. They didn't give their names, because the colonel wasn't going to write down the names of women they had in their unit, because they get in trouble because they didn't discover them. But they just write down the military, regardless if you're a woman or female, they have to account for you. Okay? So when those 5 women died and they asked for replacement, they just said 5 women. It was 5 women. And they sent them replacement. It was difficult serving in the West. You got miles and miles of prairie. Remember, they had to go across the Llano Estacada. There's nothing out there but cactus to lead the way. They had Indian scouts that led them back. The food in base was better than marching, because you had to cook. Each company had their own cook. The 38th Infantry had their own cook. The white soldiers had their own cook. They didn't eat together. They didn't sleep together. They was on their side of the base and we was on our side of the base. But we did occasionally have to fight together, because we would always be back up for them. And the Native Americans, they were more afraid of the infantry than the cavalry, because we had these long guns with the bayonet on it. because when the Indian tried to attack us, they're riding on a horse, so I stabbed them with the bayonet. Now they're on the ground, just like I am. So all the stories about the Buffalo Soldiers, mostly they talk about the stuff that the 10th Cavalry did in Kansas, but the 9th Cavalry was here in Texas, and the 38th Infantry was here in Texas, and they had to fight against Victoria and Corner Parker. Those are not easy people. It took them a long time. They never did catch Victoria. He went into Mexico, and the Mexican people killed him. And Corner Parker finally surrendered. When Corner Parker surrendered to the reservation, that ended the Indian Wars. After that, they don't allow any Native American to call themselves chief in the United States. Was the diet in the military? As we were marching, most of the time, it's salt, bacon, and beans, and hardtack. When you get in base, then you have a better diet because you have a cook. But when you're out on campaign and you're going from station fort to fort, then it's salt, bacon, and beans. And if you got a good scout, he might bring you some wild food that he captures. But that was mostly the diet. After I got out of the military, I went to Pueblo, Mexico first. I married a no-count man. He moved to Trinidad. He stayed there for a while, and he tried to sneak off with my mules and my watch. So I went and got the sheriff on him, and he got back my stuff. So I left I left Pueblo and went to Trinidad because I didn't want to have to kill him. They put him in jail for a while, but they let him out. So I went to Trinidad and stayed in Trinidad. That's where I stayed. I had all my surgeries in Trinidad. First, they amputated all the toes on my right foot. Then proceeded to amputate all the toes on my left foot. So by this time, it's 1891, and I'm in failing health. I can't really work or take care of myself. And the people that I'm working for, they're really taking care of me. They paid for the lawyers. They didn't get their money's worth because they didn't do me any justice. Because they wrote Cathay Williams, they could have threw it all the way out because the military, you have to go by the name that's on your document. If that is not the correct name, you're not going to get anything. All the people that's veterans know what I'm talking about. Because they put Cathay Williams, but the adjutant general, he said he was going to nip this in the bud. He said, I have a soldier that was in Captain Clark Company A, William Cathy. And yes, you can examine this person. So I went and took the examination and everything, but then the adjutant general rejected me because of what I put on the enlistment papers and what was on the discharge papers. Because the military go by your papers. Whatever your documents say, if you're going to get anything, it has to be documented. You had to have this injury while you was in service. So since it was no documentation all those times, I was in the hospital 7 times. Going, and it for Cummins. Nowhere does it say that I had frostbite. Nowhere does it say that. So that's why he rejected me.
How did you find out about William Cathy?
Found out about Williams Cathy from my grandfather and great-grandfather. They told me the story. They told me the stories about Cathy and all the other Buffalo soldiers because they were stationed at Fort Griffin, Fort Richardson, Fort Robinson, and then they came back and mustered out at Fort Griffin. So every summer when I'd go home to Sanford for the country, I see my grandpa, he would tell me the stories of his father being in the military and his uncles being in the military. And they always told me this story about this woman who snuck in the Army, but she was 16 years old. That fascinated me because she was 16 and snuck in the Army. And I thought that was a great story. And I asked Grandpa, I said, is that true? He said, well, you can read and write, look it up. So I did. I got her documents from the National Archive. And I've been telling this story ever since I was about 7 years old at rodeos, at church socials, at events, and especially at family reunions. I'd always tell the story about William Cathy and Stagecoach Mary Fields, Joanna July, and Henrietta Foster. I always tell those stories as I learn.
What does William Cathy mean to you personally?
Like I say, she was 16 years old. She made her way, and she was independent. My mother and grandmother taught me to be an independent woman, not to depend on nobody for my survival. So she made her way west. She survived by herself. And that's a hard thing to do as a woman in the 1800s. But she did it. And I was inspired that she was 16 years old when she did that.
And storytelling a tradition in your family?
Yes, storytelling is a tradition in our family because we learn the stories of our ancestors that came before us, how they came here to Texas, where they lived, what they did, the contributions that they made to this state and to the United States. And they expected me to learn all these stories and instill them in my grandkids. And I've done that, and I'm working on my great-grand to tell them these stories. So that's why we do the storytelling.
Tell us about your traditions.
Our tradition of storytelling, because remember, in slavery, they were not allowed to read and write. So the only way you can carry on a story, and you have to instill it in this child. And we had to repeat back what they told us, word for word. We had to learn it word for word. It was not written down. Sometimes the ones that could sing, they put it in a song for them. Since I can't sing, they had to tell me the story. So I had to memorize word for word, and I had to repeat back to them. And they would reward me. When he'd tell me a story, and I could tell it back to him word for word, he'd give me a big silver dollar. Man, do you know how much I love a silver dollar? I still collect them to this day.
Thank you for coming today.